We're doing about antihistamines. So these are the group of drugs which are used against the histamine receptors. So we'll discuss their story, how it's gonna act, what is the importance of those drugs, when they are used, how the mechanism, everything we'll discuss in this video, right? So I wrote here two generations of the antihistamines, but let's not talk about these drugs right now. First, let's discuss something about histamine itself, right? So histamine present all over our body, right? Histamine is present everywhere, but predominantly it's present in lungs, skin, GI tract, and blood vessels, right? So the histamine receptor also located in these areas in a large number of quantities when compared to the other part of the body. So that is why whenever we have allergy or maybe allergic reactions, we have skin itch. So that is due to predominant presence of the histamine compared to other organs, right? So how this histamine acts, we should know. And how this histamine is produced, we should know. So when this histamine is produced, as a result of allergic reactions, histamine is produced. So if histamine is produced, I should have something like from where it is produced, where it is stored, right? So we have some cells called mast cells. In our body, we have some cells called mast cells. So these are the cells. The cells have granules. Within the granules of the mast cells, the histamine is located. For example, let's take this is a mast cell, right? What will happen? Within the mast cell, there is some granules. So in which there is a histamine is present, right? Whenever I break this mast cell, the histamine, whatever is stored, produced, right? So which means whenever I degranulate a mast cell, histamine is released. So from where does histamine come to mast cell? That is an important thing, right? So we have an amino acid called histidine. So this histidine is the amino acid which form the histamine. So how this histidine forms histamine? By a process called decarboxylation. So I am telling decarboxylation is happening. It should happen with the enzyme called histidine decarboxylase. So whenever histidine undergoes decarboxylation, histamine is produced. So this histamine, whatever is produced, it should be immediately stored in the mast cell or maybe anywhere in the body. So if it is not stored, we have some enzyme called aminooxidase. So if I am not storing the histamine, what will happen? This aminooxidase will act on the histamine and it will break the histamine. It will damage the histamine. So to escape the action of aminooxidase, the histamine should be stored within the cells. So this is the production of the histamine and they are stored in the mast cells, right? So we'll discuss how histamine acts in our body, right? So histamine acting in our body, which means histamine has a receptors. So action of histamine by histamine receptors. So if it is a histamine receptor, we can represent it with H, right? So histamine receptor, I am representing it with H. It has 5 types: H1, H2, H3, H4 and H5. But clinically we have only 2 receptors which are important. One is H1 and the other one is H2. So H2, the drugs of the H2 and the story of the H2 will be discussed with GI drugs, but which I am going to do it today in the end of the video. Now we'll discuss about H1, right? So H1 receptors also act with histamine, H2 also act with histamine. Whenever I stimulate these H1 receptors, what will happen? My blood vessels will be dilated, so it will cause vasodilation. So I am telling vasodilation is happening. What will happen? This histamine go and act on the receptors which is in the blood vessel, histamine 1 receptors. They will cause vasodilation by release of nitric oxide. So this nitrous oxide will cause the vasodilation. So there is a histamine action on the endothelium of the blood vessel. Right. In the skin, what it will do? It will cause itching. So whenever I stimulate this receptor, the itching will be started. So whenever histamine is released, it will go on and act on the receptors of the histamine and it will start itching. That is why whenever we have an allergic reaction, maybe urticaria, we will have itching, right? And lungs, it will cause bronchoconstriction. So this is the effect of the receptors whenever they are stimulated. When I am telling bronchoconstriction is happening, along with that, we have like allergic reactions and inflammatory mediators. So whenever the histamine receptors are activated, they also participate in the release of the inflammatory mediator. So this is a story of our histamine receptors, right? So H2 are the special type of receptor. They are located in GAT. Where exactly in GAT? In GAT we have in stomach, right? So I want to tell you one more effect of the histamine that is majorly important. It is also a neurotransmitter in the CNS. So if I am telling it is a neurotransmitter, histamine receptor is also present in my CNS. If it is present in my CNS, if I am blocking the drugs, means if I am blocking with the antihistamines, I will have a sedating effect. So this is the story of the histamine receptors. So what is the use of these drugs? We have two generations, right? First we'll discuss the names of the drugs, then we'll discuss the effects and uses, right? So first generation of antihistamines, we have promethazine, doxylamine, diphenhydramine, cyclizine, meclizine, clemastine. So these are the first generation, means these are the old drugs. So these are the drugs which are produced as antihistamines in the first place. Right, and the second generation means the latest drugs, which include cetirizine, levocetirizine, loratadine, aprivastatin, and azelastine. So these are the second generation of antihistamine drugs. So if I am telling first generation and second generation, there should be a difference, right? So we'll discuss their uses and we'll discuss the their differences. Means why and what is the difference between the first generation drugs and the second generation drugs. So before I go to their uses, I want to tell you one more thing about this histamine. So if I am telling these histamine drugs are acting as an antihistamine, so which means if there is a histamine receptor, for example H1 receptor, whenever I put antihistamines, it is blocking, I mean inhibiting, right? So if it is getting inhibited or blocked, these antihistamine drugs, not only on the histamine receptors, they also have effect on the adrenoreceptors, cholinoreceptors, and also on the serotonin receptor. So they have a slight inhibitory effect on all three of these receptors, which means whenever I am putting antihistamine drug, so they also can inhibit adrenoreceptor, cholinoreceptor and serotonin receptor, which means they have a effect as a adrenoblocker, cholinoblocker and serotonin blocker, but not prominent effect, but still they have a slight effect on the these receptors, right? So histamine is very important during our allergic reactions, right? If histamine is very important during allergic reactions, I can use it in the all type of allergies. So that includes allergic rhinitis, so I want to tell you one more thing. Whenever I am using antihistamine, they don't really decrease the symptom, but they will prevent the prolongation of the symptom. Means if I am having a rhinitis today, if I take antihistamines, they are not going to be helpful for me. The effect of the antihistamine will be, I won't have the symptoms for the later life. I mean, I won't have the symptoms for tomorrow. So that is the importance. So they are more actually preventive type of the drugs. So they are like more prophylactic to the allergic diseases. Urticaria means it is a skin allergic reaction. Allergic conjunctivitis. allergic conjunctivitis. So these are the conditions where we use our antihistamine drugs. But you may have one doubt right now. Why can't we use it during anaphylaxis? So you have a doubt. Already anaphylaxis is a allergic reaction. Why can't we use it? But anaphylaxis is majorly mediated by, majorly the effect is produced with the action of epinephrine. Sorry, not epinephrine, it's epinephrine. So, this is the drugs, the epinephrine used during anaphylaxis, but not the antihistamines, right? These antihistamines also used for the treatment of motion sickness. For the treatment of motion sickness. So, whatever the drugs which I am telling, these are the H1 blockers. I'll write it here. H1 blockers. Because you may think that these are the drugs which can inhibit H2. No, they are the only for H1 blockers, right? All these indications for the H1 blockers, we'll discuss H2 receptor blocker separately, right? So motion sickness, how we use it for motion sickness? We have a drug something called scopolamine. Right, along with the scopolamine, we add one or the other antihistamine drugs so that, H1 blockers. Which means they are used along with the scopolamine. Why? Because it is thought to be like this. The antihistamine drugs also has a cholinoblocking effect. So they thought that, they're thinking that the antihistamines, which the drugs which go and block the cholinoreceptors in our CNS, means that is how we are getting effect of motion, treating of the motion sickness. So these are the uses of our antihistamines, right? Now we'll discuss what is the difference between first generation H1 blockers and second generation H1 blockers. So first generation H1 blockers, they penetrate CNS, means they cross the blood-brain barrier easily. So if first generation is crossing the blood-brain barrier easily, they have a sedating effect. So that is why generally the drugs which contain diphenyletramine is most commonly they are used as a cough syrups in India. They have a sedating effect. And also they have more effect on other receptors. Why I am telling more effect on other receptors? Because they are not only more selective to the H1, they also have effect on cholino and adreno receptors. So that is a major side effect, that is a major difference between the first and second generation. Means these are the second generation drugs, they are the latest ones, they have very less sedating effect. Second generation have less sedating effect, right? And they are more specific, they are more selective to H1. More selective to H1 receptors, means they block only H1 receptors more prominently. So if I am telling this one, why can't we use these drugs itself? Because we can't use this, especially in the people who need more attention during their works, or maybe if they want to use it for a daytime, it is a contraindication, right? So this is a story of our H1 blockers. Right, we will discuss H2 blockers. So before going to H2 blockers, I'll tell you pharmacokinetics and dynamics. These are well absorbed in our GIT, so we can use these drugs. They have a long half-life, they have prolonged effect also. So we'll discuss about H2 blockers. It is very small topic, and we'll finish our antihistamines. So H2 receptors, I told you earlier where they are located, H2 are in our GI tract, right? Where exactly they are located? They are located in the parietal cells, in GIT, in stomach, in the parietal cells. So if they are located in the parietal cells, they should be involving in the one or the other way for the acid secretion. So let's draw a simple diagram here. So let's consider this is a cell, right? This is the lumen of the stomach, right? So this is the cell. Here we have some cells called enterochromaffin like cells. What they are called? Enterochromaffin like cells. Those are called as ECL like cells, right? So these cells are present in the our stomach. So we have a receptors. We have some receptor over here. Let's take this is a receptor, right? We have some more receptors. Right. So we have three types of receptors. One is histamine receptor, H2. One is cholinoreceptor, and the other one is receptor for gastrin. Right. So I told you three receptors. Whenever histamine receptors, or maybe whenever cholinoreceptors, whenever gastrin receptors are activated, they stimulate acid secretion by proton exchange. They stimulate acid secretion by proton exchange. Means if I block this receptor, there is no acid formation. If I block this receptor, there is no acid formation. If I block this receptor, there is no acid formation. But if I block only this one, they are there to produce the acid, right? So we will discuss about that here. So I told enterochromaffin cell, I'm drawing enterochromaffin cell here. And whenever these gastrin and cholinoreceptors, they are very less active. So whenever they are less active, they stimulate these choline and gastrin, they stimulate enterochromaffin like cells. They stimulate enterochromaffin like cells, means gastrin and choline, means acetylcholine, right? So when they stimulate acetylcholine and gastrin, when they stimulate enterochromaffin like cells, they produce histamine. Again, this histamine act via histamine receptor, means the histamine will come and act on the histamine receptor, then there will be a production of acid, means predominant action is done by histamine and histamine receptors. So these H2 blockers are the drugs which block this histamine receptor. Whenever I am blocking this histamine receptor, there is no more production of acid. So if there is no more production of acid, we know the indication hyperacidity, GERD, many other diseases of the stomach. We can use the H2 blockers. So H2 blockers include ranitidine, cimetidine, and we have many other drugs. So these are the drugs which are act as a H2 blockers. So this is the story of our antihistamines. But antihistamines, whenever we are discussing, they are majorly about H1 blockers. H2 blockers always discuss with the GI drugs. So this is about histamines. Thank you. Keep following.